gonna be late for school, now.
Yes, I'm up.
Come on, now.
I'm getting up.
We're leaving.
I'll be down in 5 minutes.
Nope, we're leaving now. Come, get up. Now.
I mean.
Did you finish your homework?
I don't know.
Did you finish your homework?
I did most of it.
You'll go finish your homework right now. Go.
You'll finish your homework.
Excuse me?
Nothing.
Do you want me to tell your father what you just said
to
me?
No, okay, I'm sorry. I take it back. I'm sorry.
What do you want for dinner? Okay, I'll make spaghetti.
I don't want spaghetti.
Well, then what do you want?
I don't know.
What?
I don't know. I don't care.
I'm making spaghetti then.
No, I don't want that.
No phones at the dinner table. Put it up. Right now.
All right.
Did you talk to any girls today?
No way.
Of course you didn't, Dory.
Shut up.
Watch how you talk to your sister.
She's being mean to me. I hate you. You're the worst sister in the world. I hate you as you're never born.
All right, that's it, boy. Go to your room.
What? I didn't even do anything.
I'm getting my belt.
She started.
You can go. Do what your father says.
No, I'm sorry.
Get up and go to your room now. You want more whoopings?
What?
You're about to get more whoopings. Go.
Have you ever had one of those mornings where you just couldn't do anything right as a parent? I mean, sure, you pull out all the best tricks, like deep breaths, reasoning, calling them cute names, and then guilting them, threatening them, finally giving your just biggest ugh. Then you have nothing intelligent, spiritual, or appropriate left to say, and you blow up. No, that's never happened to you. Me neither. But if you're like me as a parent, having your authority challenged brings to surface a monster within you that you definitely don't like to see, so you know it's not pleasant for your family as well. And all of a sudden, it's an ultimate cage match. You know, mano a mano, Rocky versus Drago. It's time for Darth Vader to crush the rebellion once and for all. But here's a truth that I think we all need to remind ourselves in the time of attempted hostile takeovers from our teenagers. Sometimes it's easy to forget that you can win the argument and force the right behavior, but lose the heart in the process. As your students get older, your parenting style changes. Timeouts and spankings no longer work on 14-year-olds. Having a louder voice doesn't always make your growing adolescent back down. Now, I haven't had the distinct opportunity or pleasure of parenting a teenager yet, but from the conversations I've had with parents, one thing has become clear. Winning an argument doesn't always mean you really won. And you probably know what I'm talking about. Whether it's with your kids or your spouse, there are conversations you have where you know you're right, yet you communicated in a way that did not speak love. Now, every family fights, but there's a world of difference when you fight with someone and when you fight for their heart. When you fight with them, relationships are jeopardized, but when you fight for them, relationships are prioritized. In the book, Parenting Beyond Your Capacity, Reggie Joyner writes, "The problem with rules and reasons is that you can debate them, but you can't debate a trusted relationship. One of the most powerful things a parent can do is to learn to communicate in a style that values the relationship." So stop and think for a second. What's your communication style? Do you demand respect? Do you stop and listen? Do you try to win, or do you try to understand? You know, St. Francis of Assisi has a great quote that says, "Seek to understand and then seek to be understood." And in the book of James, Jesus's brother writes, "Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to be angry." There are so many different ways to communicate when you're in a relationship with someone. And I think we all know that how we say something is just as important as what we say. And fighting for the heart isn't just about fighting with our families, though. You know, there's a spiritual force that actively fights for the hearts of the next generation every day. Fighting for the heart of our children means preparing them, investing in them, coaching them. It's about surrounding them with other adults who have gone before them, who want to be for them. And this may come as a shock, but the spiritual maturity of a middle schooler and a high schooler looks vastly different. In the book, It's Just a Phase, the authors talk about these differences. Middle schoolers relate to God's story because it redeems their story. You know, last week we talked about how middle schoolers think like engineers. And tweens who think like engineers need to know that God can rebuild a story even when things haven't gone according to the plan. They relate to a God who overcomes impossible odds to rebuild what is broken, to bring stability, restore peace, resolve doubt, give hope, and redeem everyone. And when you affirm their personal journey, you help a middle schooler own their faith and value a faith community. Sometimes the best thing we can do for our students is to affirm that journey that they are on and help them discover that they can discover their story as a part of God's story. So here are three quick ideas to help middle schoolers mature in their relationship with God. The first idea is to connect the dots. An engineer may have to connect physics and design in order to solve a problem. And in the same way, this is the phase when a kid begins connecting the information they learned in childhood to see how it works together. That means this is the very best phase to connect the overarching narrative of Scripture. There is incredible potential to re-engage their sense of wonder about the Bible when their eyes are open to the masterful way that the story connects not only from Genesis to Revelation, but to their own life as well. The second idea is to expect a crisis. When engineers try to solve complex problems in creative ways, a few crisis moments are inevitable. Some middle school crises may seem less complex, like when they're selected to go on stage for duct tape roundup, but they may also begin to discover they believe a lot of things that don't easily fit together. They may ask tough questions like how an all-powerful God allows things to happen, bad things to happen. And you won't know all the answers, so let me free you from feeling like you have to act like you do. Just affirm what you do know and help them anchor their faith to what is constant. And the final idea for middle schoolers is to be consistent. So speaking of constant, you may never have a phase where predictability matters more. Practice making regular promises and then following through in simple ways to prove that you can be trusted. And it may seem like at some points they're testing you, because guess what? They actually are. Absolutely nothing you say will matter for a middle schooler unless you say it with credibility that you earn simply by showing up in their world to prove you care. Now let's get to high schoolers, those mini adults who seem like they grow exponentially every day. High schoolers relate to a God whose story empowers their story. Teenagers who think like philosophers look for principles that will give their story meaning. They relate to a God who guides their decisions, promotes love and forgiveness, empowers their freedom, enables them to live more fully, moves them toward a greater purpose and identity, and connects them to a bigger story. And when you mobilize their potential, you help a high schooler keep pursuing authentic faith and discover a personal mission. This looks like encouraging them to go on a mission trip during the summer. This also looks like seeing a gift that God has given them and equipping them with opportunities to use those gifts to serve God and help others. And just like with our middle schoolers, I want to give you three ideas to help our high schoolers mature in their relationship with God. The first one is to give them an application. Now, don't let the term philosopher confuse you. You know, high schoolers, they want more than theory. They want to know what is helpful for life right now. And the best way to help a high schooler remember what you say is to say something that they can do this week. Give them a way to see how what you say and what you do or what they do connect to the bigger picture. The second idea is to ask them questions. Philosophers ask questions. If they aren't asking hard questions, if they're not asking you hard questions, they're asking someone else. That's just what high schoolers do. They want to know how what you say connects to their real world experience. And I want you to resist the temptation to defend or over-explain your theology, because anything you talk them into now, someone else can talk them out of later. Give them their space. Do what Jesus did. Answer their questions with another question. So if they ask you a question, ask them their thoughts first. What do you think about this? Guide them to discover the answer on their own if you want it to stick. And the last idea for high schoolers is to make it experiential. High schoolers will never feel important until you give them something important to do. They're ready for freedom. They want to do something that matters. They want a little less conversation and more action in their life. Now is the time to give your high schooler every opportunity to use their skills to serve and be the church while they are still with you. Okay, so let's get even more practical. When you fight for the heart, you take the moments from Deuteronomy 6 and add them to your family routine. Here's what that says. And you must commit yourselves wholeheartedly to these commands that I'm giving you today. Repeat them again and again to your children. Talk about them when you're at home and when you're on the road, when you're going to bed and when you're getting up. In other words, mealtime, drive time, bedtime, and morning time. So thinking about this, how can you leverage your meals to create warmth around the table? You know, last week we talked about the idea of wow, pow, and holy cow. If you have no idea what I'm talking about, go check it out if you haven't watched it yet. So what about drive time? What if you turned your drive time into asking each other fun questions, would you rather questions, or funny icebreaker questions? If you're anything like our family, bedtime can be sweet, chaotic, and frustrating all at the same time. But what if you begin speaking a blessing over your kid every night? What if you chose a word that you feel describes how God created them and spoke that into them each night that you're with them? Finally, there's the morning. I know we have teens on both ends of the spectrum when it comes to waking up. Some of them are up before you're up, while others you have to resort to ice baths to wake them up. But what if you started each morning maybe playing some worship music on a speaker? You know, if breakfast is the most important meal of the day, then maybe breakfast time is the most crucial time to set the tone for the rest of the day. And the key question we have to ask ourselves as we wrap up today is, how am I fighting for the heart of my child? I want to challenge you to think about this principle and how what it looks like for you and your family. How can you talk about these things together and come up with a commitment to each other to be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry? Remember, final thoughts, one of the most powerful things a parent can do is learn to communicate in a way that values the relationship by fighting for the heart.